Let us see topic 2.3, measurement of length, in chapter 2, units and measurement. Measurement of length can be done by two methods, that is direct method and indirect method. In direct method, we use different type of instruments like meter scale, like vernier calipers, like micrometer screw gauge, or sometimes just known as micrometer, and spherometer. You have already seen meter scale and you might have used this type of meter scale. Vernier calipers, micrometer and spherometer, that will come in your 11th standard physics practicals. Right now, let us see the basic uses of this instrument. By meter scale, we can measure minimum up to 10⁻³ meter, that is 1 millimeter. And maximum you can go up to 10⁻², that is 100 meter or something. By vernier calipers, we can measure even more accurately. That means it can measure up to 10⁻⁴ meter, that is 0.1 millimeter. By this vernier calipers, you can measure even the diameter of the nib of a ball pen. Then comes micrometer screw gauge and spherometer. They both can measure up to 10⁻⁵ meter, that is 0.01 millimeter or say 0.1 micrometer. This micrometer screw gauge can easily measure diameter of our hair. Let us see indirect method. In indirect method, the object is not near us, that's why we cannot measure the distance by using the instruments like meter scale and vernier calipers or something like that. Or sometimes the object is very, very small that we cannot put even the vernier calipers or micrometer screw gauge and so on. So in this method, we have to go with some indirect methods. In indirect method, we use plenty of things. We use many equations of physics. We use trigonometry sometimes. We use some estimation method and so on. Here are a few examples of indirect method. The first one is parallax method. Parallax method is the next one what we are going to learn. Then is monomolecular method, that is used to measure the diameter of any molecule of any substance. That also we will learn later on. Next is sonar system of measuring distance. You might have heard about this sonar word. It is used in many places but mostly used in submarine. In submarine, when it is in sea water, the visibility is not more than 20-30 feet. So to come to know about any object at a distance, they use sonar. Sonar basically produces audio signals. This audio signal travels up to that object and return back. So within this travel, this signal takes some time. From that time and the speed of the sonar signal, we can come to know the distance of that object. So this is obviously an indirect method. Then is estimating height of an object from its shadow. This we do in our day-to-day life also. For example, if this pen is standing somewhere in a daylight and you can see a shadow here, the light is, let us say, coming from here and it is producing a shadow here, and the shadow is, let us say, of 2 feet. So from that 2 feet, you know that this is the length of the pen. Now, if any object is having a shadow of double the length at the same time, at the same place almost. If the shadow is having a double length, then obviously the height of that object will be double than this object, than this pen. So, this is what estimating height of an object from shadow. So, these are some examples of indirect methods. Now, let us see topic 2.3.1, that is measurement of large distances, basically by parallax method. Large distance, such as the distance between Earth and Moon, distance between Earth and planet, distance between Earth and star, and so on, that cannot be measured by obviously some meter scale or something like that. So we need to use some indirect method. One of that indirect method is parallax method. Now, first of all, let us understand what is parallax. To understand this parallax method, hold a pen in front of you against some specific point in the background, that is a dot on a wall. Now, look at the pen first through your left eye, keeping your right eye closed, and then look at the pen through your right eye, keeping your left eye closed. You would notice that the position of the pen seems to change with respect to the dot on the wall. This is called as parallax. Let me explain it to you. Hold this pen in front of you. Now, through this pen, see any far distance point, let us say a dot on that wall. First, see that dot through this pen, keeping one eye closed and another eye open, and then keep another eye closed and the first eye open. You will see that this pen is shifting. Basically, it is not shifting, but it seems like it is shifting. That is known as parallax. Basically, our vision through these two eye is focused on that point. Now, because the vision sight, or say the line of sight from this eye and this eye are different, that's why when you see any object through this pen or something like that, so you feel like shifting of this object, and that is known as parallax. Now, this can be used to measure a distance of any planet or star or moon or something like that. How it is so? Let us see. Measuring the distance of planet by parallax method. First, let us determine the distance d of a planet. Here, this is planet and this is Earth surface. Here is the Earth surface. And from this Earth surface, we need to find out the distance of this planet. The distance of this planet is, let us say, d. First, observe the planet from two different positions, let us say two different observatories, A and B, from the Earth, separated by a distance AB, that is small b. At the same time, what you have to do? From this Earth surface, you have to choose two points, let us say two observatory. Obviously, to observe it, we need some observatory which is having a very big heavy telescope. So, let us say here is the first telescope and here is the second telescope, and at the same time, you have to observe through these two telescopes the same planet S. So, AS is the one observation direction and BS is another observation direction, and the distance between these two telescopes, that is AB, is let us say equal to B. AB is equal to, let us say, B. Now, measure the angle theta between two observation directions AS and BS. Here, this theta is called as parallax angle or parallactic angle. These are the two observation direction AS and BS, and that is making an angle theta. This theta is known as parallax angle or parallactic angle. As the planet is very far, that is the distance d is very, very larger than the distance small b between that two telescopes, this angle theta will be very small. See, if we consider a real practical example, then obviously the planet will be very far, not as it is shown in this figure, but practically it will be very far. And in that case, if you take two observatories even, which is very far, let us say one is in Delhi and one is in Kanyakumari even, then also the distance theta for that planet or star, whatever you take, will be very, very small. This figure is showing a large angle theta, that is only for explanation. But in practice, this theta angle will be very small. So, in that case, we can approximately take AB as an arc of radius SA or radius SB with the center as S. Now, with this figure, we can consider S as a center and AB as an arc. So, this SA and SB becomes the radius and AB can be considered as an arc, keeping S as the center. So, for this situation now, we can apply our very well known equation, that is arc is equal to radius into angle. Now, let me repeat. Here this is arc, this is radius SA or SB, whatever you say, and here is the angle theta. So, as per that, arc is AB, radius is SA and angle is theta. But SA and SB are same and that will be almost equal to D. Let me show you again. This SA and SB will be almost equal to D in practice, not here. Here it doesn't appear like that, but in practice, if you really think about Earth's surface and a very far distance object like, let us say, moon or let us say planet or something like, these two radius will be almost equal to D. And so, SA is equal to SB and that is almost equal to D. So, we can now put these values in this equation. So, we can place B at the place of AB, we can place D at the place of SA and theta is here. That's why we get B is equal to D into theta. And so, we can now put this equation as D is equal to B upon theta. This is the equation by which we can find out D. D, that is the distance between Earth and the planet. Now, measuring the diameter of planet by parallax method. Up to here we have measured the distance of the planet. Now, we can find out the diameter of the planet by the same parallax method. Let us see how. Having determined D, we can employ a similar method to determine the size of the diameter of the planet. Here, this is the Earth's surface again, and now this is the planet. Here I have shown a zoomed view of planet. Note here that the distance between planet and Earth is again showed as capital D only, and the diameter of this planet is small d. Mind well, it is small d. Now, using the same previous method, that means arc is equal to radius into angle, we can go here also. Here, keeping this point as center, I can take this as an arc and this becomes the radius. That's why we can write again arc is equal to radius into angle. So, D is equal to D into alpha. That's why here it is D is equal to D into alpha. Here D is the diameter of that planet what we want to measure. Mind well, to measure this diameter, first we need capital D, that is the distance of that planet. And again, the angle theta and alpha are in radian. Always remember, while putting the angle in this equations, whether this equation or this equation, both the angles should be kept in radian, not in degree.